The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook. Friend me on Twitter or follow me on Facebook. Friend me on Twitter. Go to the David Feldman Show website and do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. And we get a small percentage of everything you make. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. We're lousy with Amazon banners. And just click on that and then shop away. There's a lot of garbage in your life. You don't need things. The holiday season is coming up. You do not need more crap. Here's what I recommend that you do. There's a problem with fake news. People are passing along information from phony Macedonian websites. This is true. There are kids in Macedonia who have created these phony websites. They have clickbait. It's all lies, pro-Trump. It gets spread through social media. Google and Facebook are trying to crack down on this. The reason Donald Trump got elected president, one of the reasons Donald Trump got elected president, is lack of trust that we have for facts. And as you know, on this show, we deal with facts. We deal with the truth that comes from well-respected, venerated institutions like the New York Times, The Nation magazine, the White House, this White House. We're not going to defeat Trump and his people unless we deal with well-educated journalists, and journalists need to be supported. So what you should do this holiday season is not wait in line on Black Friday at Best Buy to get a television set. What you do is you go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Click on my Amazon banner, go to Amazon, and type in New York Times subscriptions. Type in The Nation magazine. Type in The Economist. Type in The Washington Post. And give those out as gift subscriptions to your loved ones. That will help save the Republic or reinvent the Republic. I think we lost the Republic in 2000. But we can have a second republic, one that's enlightened and informed, and vote with your pocketbook, vote with your wallet. Find out who is supporting Trump. Don't give them any money. Make sure that your dollars are not spent on anybody who facilitates the Trump presidency. Now, I'm going to fight Trump every step of the way, because you need people on the left who are filled with anger, not hatred, anger. I'm going to fight him every step of the way. I know I'm calming down. I understand that Bernie, and I understand that Chuck Schumer, who is now the Senate minority leader, I understand that they have to work with Trump. I get that. Politics is compromise. But people on the left have an obligation to push the Democratic Party further and further to the left, not towards the center. So I will forgive Bernie for saying, you know, if Trump has an infrastructure plan that's going to put people to work, I'll support him on that. I understand that. Plus, I take my cues from Bernie. If Bernie says something, he knows more than I do. Not Chuck Schumer, Bernie. So if Bernie says work with Trump, I understand that, and I will accept that. But I am going to fight personally Trump every step of the way because I'm angry. I'm not hateful. That's the difference between the populist uprising in the Republican Party and the populist uprising in the Democratic Party. Bernie tapped into anger. Trump tapped into hatred. There are votes out there for the Democratic Party to get from the Trump side. We need to find the people who are angry and voted for Trump and bring them to our side. The hateful people, they're never going to go away. There are always going to be the Steve Bannons and the David Dukes who are going to vote for Trump. But there are angry people who were confused by misinformation, fake news stories coming out of Macedonia. They conflated their own anger with hatred. They need to be informed. And it is the role of the left now, right now, to be understanding of the people who voted for Trump out of anger and not hatred. We need to gently, by the way, Scott Blakeman is here. I think of gentle people. We need to gently bring people over to our side. You're not going to get the racists, but you're not going to get the angry people to come to us if you treat them like racists, if you treat them like they're idiots. That's what we have to do. You have to gently educate your Trump-supporting friends, if they're not inveterate racists, homophobes, and misogynists. Now, I'm going to get to a more brilliant human being, Scott Blakeman, in a second. I'm an old white male who has benefited from the patriarchy. I vote properly, but deep down inside, I got a lot to lose if you know, white privileged males lose their status. I'm being partially facetious, but I do understand why white men are frightened. And I suggest that our side teach, instead of saying to white men like me, and I have several women in my life who I've asked to explain things to me gently. Explain it to me. I'm a dinosaur. Explain it to me. They have said to me, if you're too stupid to know what I'm up against, just go away. Okay, they're right. They're right. But the best way to deal with somebody like me is to teach me. Teach me. Most Americans, especially men, are dogs. We're dogs. We can be taught new tricks, but you have to teach us. There's been a little condescension on the left towards scared white men. You're not going to take their anger, which we need, and bring it to us if you push them away. There's a lot for old dinosaurs to process. I want to bring up Caitlyn Jenner, who, by the way, is a right-wing whatever. I think she voted for Trump, as did Kanye West. And this, to me, is an example of why, just this is probably not a big reason that Trump won, but I think it has something to do with why Trump won. I didn't understand. My heart is in the right place, okay? I never understood transgender people. I was in a bubble. I was married. I was raising kids. I would often hear about transgender rights, and I would say to my very understanding wife at the time, I don't get what this is about. She would say, well, you know, you look in the mirror and you see your hair plugs and you think you have hair. Doesn't that make you feel good? And I went, oh, okay, I get that. Okay, thank you for explaining that to me. And then I started doing these jokes about 5 years ago on my podcast and the radio show on KPFK, which has a very liberal, forget liberal, far left audience. And there was a meme at the time, it's still going on, calling Ann Coulter a man. All the jokes about Ann Coulter, they go back 9 years. She's got an Adam's apple. She's really a man. She's got a dick. And it always got a laugh. And then all of a sudden, I started getting emails saying that joke is offensive. I responded angrily saying, oh, come on, this is exactly why Reagan got elected. That there was a backlash to the civil rights movement. Everybody was so afraid of offending each other, and everybody went to Reagan because everybody was so hypercritical and so sensitive. And that's true, by the way. There were a lot of Reagan Democrats because a lot of people got sick of having to be understanding. I said, I'm not going to stop making these Ann Coulter is a man jokes because they're funny. And I don't know who this listener was. This person sent me, just very quietly, sent me a list of crimes against transgender people with pictures, how they get beaten up all the time, and how the cops won't prosecute these hate crimes. And I just wrote back, you won. You're right. This person didn't call me stupid. They didn't call me homophobic or transgender phobic. They didn't call me a bad person. This person educated me, and I immediately said, I will never make an Ann Coulter joke again. I will never do that. I now realize that calling Ann Coulter a man with a dick is, by doing that, you're saying she's less than. That by saying that she's a transgender person, that makes her an object of ridicule. I didn't get it. I didn't understand it. Now I do. Somebody politely explained to me why those jokes were wrong. And I learned, and I stopped. Now, yes, I should have already known that. I didn't. But I learned it. And it was done very gently by somebody who didn't want to make me feel like a bad person. My suggestion to the left is that you gently explain and then walk away. Eventually, people do learn, except for the inveterate racists. Which brings me to Caitlyn Jenner. So while you have all these white men in the Rust Belt who are losing their jobs and don't know how they're going to feed their family, there's this kind of culture war that's going on in this country. And it comes from New York and Hollywood, where you have these putative liberals like Kanye West, who, by the way, voted for Trump. Let me repeat, Kanye West walked off one of his shows this week saying he's sick of people talking about racism and he voted for Trump. Well, Kanye's, what, stepfather, mother-in-law, Caitlyn Jenner, made the cover of Vanity Fair when he became a she. It's very confusing. You know, Caitlyn is confused. She's actually thinking going back to being a man. It's very confusing for white, unemployed men in the Rust Belt or aging Jewish comedy writers to understand this stuff. Instead of focusing on Caitlyn's beauty, the media should have focused on the plight of the LGBT. I don't think anybody in America, even if they don't understand the LGBT community, I don't think anybody in America wants them to suffer. I think that's what we have to focus on in the Democratic Party, is get back to Occupy Wall Street. And I made the mistake, and then I'm going to talk to Scott. I apologize for going on about this, but I apologized in the past for focusing solely on the 99%. Back when Obama was running, I voted for Edwards because he was the only one who spoke about the two Americas, poverty, the chasm of wealth in this country. 8 years ago, I said the only person who's talking about what is important in this country is the economic divide, and that was Edwards. And I was, and I have apologized on this show. I've said 8 years ago, stop saying you're gay, Jewish, black, Asian, a woman. You're part of the 99%. Focus on the economic disparity. It's all about jobs. I apologize for saying that because I didn't understand what it meant to be a black person in this country. I thought I did. And then the iPhone was invented, and I got to see what it really means to be a black person in America. I was wrong for saying enough with the identity politics. I was wrong. I think there are white votes out there, white male votes out there that we can get in the Rust Belt if we focus a little more on economic disparity, you cannot solve the plight of African Americans and the LGBT community without dealing with homophobia and racism. And I understand that you can't solve the wage gap with women, 70% on the dollar, unless we deal with misogyny. I understand that abortion rights equals economic freedom. I'm beginning to understand that. I didn't understand that, but I'm beginning to understand that. But I think you can come to the Rust Belt white male frightened voter who's angry, not hateful, by addressing it economically. That people understand. I think there are people who hate Jews. They're in this room right now. I think there are people who hate blacks. They're always going to hate them. But they will never argue with you about a black person's right to earn a living and support their family. There are certain people you're never going to get a right-wing bigot to accept their daughter dating a black man. But they will accept a black man's right to earn a living. There are people who are never going to understand the plight of transgender people. But they will agree with you that anybody who's in the LGBT community has a right to make money. These are some stats. This is from The Advocate. 20.7% of LGBT people living alone have annual incomes of $12,000 a year. That's the poverty. 20.7% of the LGBT community who live alone have annual incomes of $12,000 a year. I can't get everybody to agree to gay marriage, but you can explain at Thanksgiving, one out of every five LGBT person who's not married makes $12,000 a year. Transgender Americans are nearly four times more likely to have a household income under $10,000 per year. To me, that is kind of important. Instead of putting Caitlyn Jenner on the cover of Vanity Fair and deciding whether or not she's beautiful, did Vanity Fair talk about that? I don't think so. Stay angry, don't be hateful, and that includes not hating the other side. We're smarter than they are. We're teachers. So if somebody's stupid, it doesn't mean they can't be taught. Our side won. We won the popular vote. And if you look at the Rust Belt, there were states where it was like 12,000 votes. We were smug. And I think it's the role of Hollywood liberals. Like, you know, I tweeted Rob Reiner, Scott. I'll introduce you in a second. Rob Reiner needs to shut up. Lena Dunham needs to shut up. They're not helping us. I know their clogged hearts are in the right place, but they turn off the Rust Belt voters. If you're making a lot of money in Hollywood, don't use your thirst for attention in politics. Make funny movies. Don't use politics as a way for you to do a dance video for Funny or Die, Lena Dunham, because you're down to what you think is an acceptable weight. And I'm not fat shaming you. That video she made, it was a turnoff. You know, Lena Dunham, she's an ally, but she's not, she writes books about placing quarters in her sister's vagina, how she felt up her sister's vagina. She starts a book tour and goes around the country and wants to bring young artists with her, but she doesn't pay them. Just make your movies and give your money to educated journalists and professors and politicians. But don't speak out publicly, because we're on the same side, but we need your money, not your voice. Because you turn off the Rust Belt. You turn off people because you don't get it yet. Just because you're famous and liberal doesn't mean you should be speaking out on issues. And the same goes for Rob Reiner. He should just shut up. He has a lot of money. Give your money to people who are articulate and know what they're talking about. And finally, the luckiest person in America last week was Leonard Cohen, because he didn't have to hear Hallelujah. Leonard Cohen is my idol. I mean, I love Dylan, but I love Leonard Cohen more than Bob Dylan. And Hallelujah is a great song. I Love Lucy is the greatest sitcom ever made. But, you know, after 500 viewings of the grape stomping episode, it stopped. You know, it's enough already. I didn't watch Kate McKinnon on Saturday Night Live sing Hallelujah. I heard it was very touching and moving. And let me tell you about Nora Dunn from San Francisco. Nora Dunn was on Saturday Night Live. Very smart, brilliant comedian. And she was on Saturday Night Live in the mid-80s, early 90s. Andrew Dice Clay, who built an entire act on misogyny, and I thought he was funny, was a character. But it's not my right to tell women what they can be offended by and what they can't be. Andrew Dice Clay normalized misogyny and violence towards women. Nora Dunn would not do Saturday Night Live when Andrew Dice Clay appeared. And she paid a price for that. Donald Trump hosted Saturday Night Live earlier this year and was normalized by Saturday Night Live, once again speaking power to truth. Saturday Night Live speaking power to truth. This was after he had called Mexicans rapists. Everybody worked with him. It's a little late to sing Hallelujah and shed a tear after Donald Trump has been elected president and was normalized by your television show. You don't get to sing Hallelujah. You didn't do what Nora Dunn did. And I know Kate McKinnon is brilliant. She is. And she's a voice for a whole generation. But I'm not going to watch her sing Hallelujah because I know it's going to bring me to tears. She doesn't deserve to sing Hallelujah. Nora Dunn, who walked off Saturday Night Live when Andrew Dice Clay was guest hosting, deserves to sing Hallelujah. And finally, you're not going to beat me, Apple, and you're not going to beat me, Microsoft. I figured out how to use Skype on a three-year-old computer. This is what they do, Scott Blakeman. Then I'm done talking, okay? I've had trouble doing interviews with people via Skype because no matter how many times I update the software, it don't work. I go to the Genius Bar, and I'm going to fight them. I am not going to give in because we've gone, and I'm coining this phrase, and this is going to be a new phrase that everybody's going to use. We've gone from planned obsolescence to planned acquiescence. In the past, they would make computers, cars, everything, and they would plan for it to become obsolete, either aesthetically or technologically. Now it's planned acquiescence. You go in, you get a mixer that doesn't work all of a sudden. Alex, that's not planned obsolescence. They do some software updates, and then they say, for another $200, you can get a brand new one. And they just know you're going to acquiesce. Well, I'm not giving in Apple, and I'm not giving in Microsoft. I have a five-year-old laptop that's sitting on my desk that I was able to edit video with. It worked just fine. And I was able to use Microsoft Word. I was able to use Final Cut. I was able to use Audacity and Skype. And then I updated, you know, those software updates, and all of a sudden nothing works. And I keep saying, take me back. I want my computer back. Forget make my country great again. Make my goddamn computer great again. Take me back to 5 years ago when this thing worked. It was fine. I had no problem with this computer. I was editing audio and video, and I was writing letters to people. I was able to use this computer, and now it doesn't work. And no, I'm not going to throw it out. You're going to fix this. I want my operating system back. Scott Blakeman is a brilliant stand-up comedian, and we will be back with Scott Blakeman after this. Scott Blakeman is a good friend of mine. We were at the 1984 Democratic Convention in San Francisco together, covering it for I don't know what it was, and I got to hear Jesse Jackson speak there. He runs Laughing Liberal. I can't. Tom Brokaw just inhabited my tongue. Laughing Liberally. It's the third Wednesday of every month at Jimmy's. Where's Jimmy's?
Jimmy's number 4343 East 7th Street in Manhattan. And look for Laughing Liberally, hopefully, around the country, because we certainly need it wherever you are.
And do you mind if I call you a political satirist?
Absolutely.
You're a great political satirist.
Well, I appreciate that coming from you. And may I just say that listening to you for the last 28 minutes, you know, there are many shows where it'd be like, why am I sitting here now when this guy's talking? Or why did I come all the way from Westchester? And to me, it's a privilege to hear you and people like John Fugelsang, who have the privilege of being on his show, too. You know, you speak with such clearness, such sanity, which is what we need right now. And you are an introspective person who, like myself, we make mistakes. But unlike most people in this world today and most liberals, conservatives, you're able to reach in and say, all right, how can I do this better? And that's what I've been grappling with ever, not just since November 8th, but ever since any woman breaks up with me, mm-hmm. Which, by the way, happened around election day. Someone broke up with me, and which was the best time for someone to break up with me, because I was so caught up with what was going to happen, what did happen, that I have no recollection of her name at this point even. So I thank you for her timing on that.
You're a very sweet what I love about your act, you and I and Nancy Giles perform together mm-hmm. occasionally, and I wish I could be you, because there's a gentleness and a sweetness to you, and you're not angry, and I'm just so snarky and I push people away. But you explain things. Your comedy kind of brings the other side to us, and it's of great value. And you also do work with Palestinian comedians.
Muslim Palestinian comedian Dino Badala, and we've been doing for 13 years now, a show called Stand Up for Peace. And it essentially is trying to bring together Jews, Arabs, Muslims, people of all backgrounds, sit in a room and laugh. And, you know, we always say if you can laugh together, you can live together. And that's what we're not doing. We're not sitting in the same room, whether we're Republicans. And it's maybe sounds a little corny, but we don't, as you said so eloquently, we don't know the other side. We don't want to know the other side. Mm-hmm. We don't want to listen to the other side. And yes, I don't want to listen to racists and anti-Semites who aren't going to change. But as you said, there are blue collar white workers in Michigan and Wisconsin and Pennsylvania who Bernie Sanders could connect to and who we can bring on our side. And I am just as appalled by the ignorance on the left, which I am obviously a part of, than I am on the right. And I can just give you just a little example. I think we still need, as you said beautifully, we should be angry but not hateful. And yes, Donald Trump appealed to anger and hate and fear. Mm-hmm. And I'm angry and outraged, and I'm going to channel it the best way I can. But what I won't accept, and I'll just go from the last hour. I mean, I woke up this morning, and against my better instincts, I posted something on Facebook, knowing that it would unleash, as it does, not an articulate political discourse, but a barrage of mean-spirited, but from my friends. You know, this mm-hmm. isn't, and just to, you know, very quickly, for those of you who don't know, last night, and let me just say that for 35 years, I've been a political comedian and also other comedy, because you can't always do political comedy. And I am a flawed person. I make a lot of mistakes. I was
like
totally,
doing this show.
No. I was totally wrong about Trump every step of the way. But I do try to connect with people. And so anyway, what happened last night was Mike Pence, who I have spoken out against for his clearly discriminatory actions as governor towards gay people. Absolutely. He attended Hamilton.
Mm-hmm.
And And I have to say, I give anyone credit for that. You know, there are plenty of Republicans, conservatives. I'm not going to see that liberal show or, you know, and he went. And what happened was there was some applause, but several people booed him.
Would you have booed?
No, well, no, absolutely not. And that was my point. And I look, and obviously people have the right to do it. He was booed. But then what later happened, the show went on, and by all accounts, he enjoyed the show. He was applauding, all that. And the show, for those, you know, I haven't seen it.
It was very hard for him to applaud with his hands constantly checking for his wallet.
Well, that was, yes, but he managed to somehow figure that out. Hamilton, I have not seen it yet because I don't have the money or the connections, but it really is a show that celebrates diversity, inclusiveness, all the great things about America. And I think the show itself was the most powerful statement you can make against the lack of inclusion, diversity that Donald Trump and Mike Pence represent. Having said that, enjoy the show. And at the end, one of the cast members gave a very, what I thought, respectful, appropriate speech, mm-hmm. saying, we welcome Mike Pence for coming. We thank him for coming. We'd like Donald Trump to come. I don't think that was in the speech. And this nation needs to be, you know, reflect the message of the show. Fine. Donald Trump, stupidly, as he does, tweeted out, you know, boy, that's offensive. Boycott Hamilton, which, of course, led to a whole barrage of obvious jokes. Like, good, now I can get to see it. But my point was this, that to my liberal friends, fellow liberal friends, how would you feel if Barack Obama or Hillary Clinton went to the theater or went to NASCAR or went to a show and were booed? And I would say, you know, we would be offended. We would say, who are these people that booing the president of the United States or the boo? And I try to pose that, being introspective, trying to be fair. And believe me, I'm going to stand up against Trump and Pence every step of the way where it means something. And yes, you have a First Amendment right. But what troubled me is that people could not see the other side, that, you know, wouldn't they be, you know, they would be offended. But they'd say, well, it's different because Obama and Hillary are great and Pence isn't. So this is a quote. We're never going to connect if we don't understand the other side. And also, again, the venom, the personal meanness. It's never thanks. I mean, a few people, but it's never like, oh, that's an interesting point. Let me just, and yes, some people did say, my friend, yeah, I love you, but most of the people, it's this very self-righteous thing. And can I just say once and for all, look, I acknowledge that anytime someone like Trump rises up, you can make parallels to dictatorships of any kind, but it's lazy and offensive to me to at every turn, Hitler, 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 Hitler. There are bad references we can make in the world that don't involve Adolf Hitler. Donald Trump, the ascension of Donald Trump and the people he's brought in, incredibly dangerous, could be horrible. And we need to be vigilant. And one of the reasons why it's not going to happen here is because Hitler did happen. We know. Having said that, when people say, how could the German people have let it? No, the American people could let it. And there could be a Hitler in this country. It's not Donald Trump, but it's going to be bad. So my point is, let's not just throw out Hitler all the time because that's lazy and say, okay, well, then you win the argument. Because how could I argue with them if they go Hitler? You know, so let me just say that again, I love what you said in the beginning, and at least you get to do it on a radio show. I do it in the shower, and I've just been missing every appointment lately because I'm so consumed by all of this, as we should be. But I just hope people take it's the comedians now. We used to be the crazy ones, and we're still crazy, but used to be the politicians were sort of sane, and we were the crazy guys trying to make up jokes. Now the insanity is in the White House, and it's up to comedians to still be funny but also try to find some sanity.
Let me talk about what you just said, and then I'm going to have a point-by-point response, and then you respond, because it was brilliant. Comparing Trump to Hitler, I disagree with you. I think you should compare Trump to Hitler. Had Hitler been compared to Hitler, Hitler never would have had the chance to become Hitler. It's okay, I think, to compare Trump to Hitler on day one, because Kristallnacht happened, I believe, in 1939 or 38. I don't have...
This past week. How many years?
Was it
probably 38.
But 39. Yeah. Hitler had a slow rise to power. It took a couple of years for him to become Hitler. And what he did was cultural appropriation and financial appropriation, which I'll talk about with Hamilton. if you don't mind.
Sure.
Okay. The reason you compare Trump to Hitler is he is using the Hitler playbook. He's all over the map. He's appropriating everybody's ideology. He was able to pick off Democrats by being a populist. He's able to pick off industrialists by being a putative billionaire. I think he's broke. He's turning down the presidential salary. He needs that money. That's why we're going to eventually he has to do a financial disclosure.
Absolutely.
And we're going to see how broke he is. He has no money, because if you have $1 billion, you're not running for president. Trust me. You're not going to be president. This was a branding operation that got way out of hand. With Hitler, you have to read Mein Kampf, because people say things and they mean them. You know, the New York Times went back and found their first article about Hitler. Did you see that?
Mm-hmm.
And what was it?
Well, sort of a puff piece. I didn't read the whole thing, but no, he was certainly treated and mocked in much the way.
But what did they say? What they said about the anti-Semitism? This was like 1923.
Oh, is it sort of like that's he doesn't really mean it?
He doesn't mean it. He's just using it to shore up his base.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's safer to compare Trump to Hitler than not to. Hitler had socialists, you know, Nazi socialists. You know, it was in their name. Trump is all over the map. He's squirrely. You can't really nail him down. That's exactly what Hitler did. You really don't know what Trump stands for. But look at who he surrounds himself with. They're fascists. They don't believe in freedom of speech. They believe in a strong military, strong police. They believe in surveillance. They are fascists, and I disagree with you. I want to talk about Hamilton, but go ahead.
Sure. Well, yes, you can. There are parallels and there are analogies, and certainly maybe closer to Mussolini. I mean, certainly yes, he has fascist tendency.
He's exactly like Mussolini, because Mussolini was completely bald too.
Yes, right. And has the same profile, I think, if you look at
yes.
it.
And the chin out is...
Yeah,
He's appropriating.
He's got
that's a conscious drawing. Appropriation.
Yeah. I guess the only thing I would say, going back to your comments earlier, is that if we are going to stop him and connect with people who could be on our side, maybe when we say Hitler reflexively, it turns people off, and maybe they go like, no, it's not that. It's not 10 million Jews... 8 million Jews being killed, so it's not that bad.
8 million?
Well, 6 million Jews, but 10 million, including gypsies and gay people and everybody else and Poles. And I mean, you know, it's a genocide. So I guess that's my point, is that if we say...
Were they killed Polish people?
Well, Poles were actually some of the biggest victims, and that's sort of a running thing in Poland, that they're blamed as the people who perpetrated the crimes, that many of them were victims too. But I guess the point is, can we have another
Must
analogy?
Must not make Polish joke. Must listen to Blakeman. Must.
Right, well, you know. But so I guess I would just say that it's a lot of things. Trump is not Hitler. His rise and the people, and what I did say earlier, the people who were drawn to him, that's a similar phenomenon.
That's an identical phenomenon.
It's an identical phenomenon. So there are identical things going on. I guess it doesn't. And again, just as you said, the fact that there was Hitler is going to be the reason why we're not going to let him become another Hitler. And we have to absolutely be vigilant every step of the way.
Yeah, I think this is more dangerous because Hitler didn't have nuclear weapons at his disposal.
I absolutely think there's a lot of danger here. But, you know, we also have America is not in as bad straits as Germany was because of our sanctions that we put on them after World War One. We're a strong country. There are at least half the country or more that is appalled by Trump. As of now, we do still have a system in place. Many Republicans aren't at odds with Trump. So, look, Steve Bannon is frightening. He is a white nationalist with anti-Semitic statements, and the fact that he's his right-hand man is appalling and scary. So there's reason to be worried, But all I say is if we just say Hitler, maybe it makes people tune out. So maybe we can semi-Hitler.
Let me get all Marshall McLuhan on you. This is a podcast. So I don't think Noam Chomsky coined the phrase manufacturing consent. I think he appropriated that. But I've been watching CNN and I've done some radio shows, and podcasts are different. We don't have to manufacture consent on a podcast. So it's pretty dangerous, a podcast. If I were doing my radio show right now, I would be manufacturing consent, because radio is so dangerous. You know, and I've said this all the time. You could not have had the genocide in Rwanda without radio. It was impossible. It was radio instructed the Hutus where to go to slice off the heads of the Tutsis. Radio is a very powerful medium, more powerful than television. Trump and radio, you would not have a Trump presidency without radio and the way the right wing, the industrialists have appropriated radio. You know, Clear Channel, which bought up all the radio stations and went bankrupt, was owned by Bain Capital when Mr. Romney was running for president. It's a miracle that Obama was able to defeat this industrialist. So I'm not manufacturing consent here. If I were doing my radio show, I would be, because you cannot be a Father Coughlin and stir up the masses. You just can't do it. Although the right wing does. I mean, Rush Limbaugh and Michael Savage, they use radio to do exactly that. For some reason, the liberals like me don't want to stir up the masses. But I will use this podcast to manufacture dissent, because these are sane people. They've made a choice to listen to my show, and they're educated and they read. And again, the dissent that I'm trying to encourage is to work within the system the way the Tea Party has, and call your congressman and your senator.
And that's why, just quickly, I just felt we still need civility. Now, I know you said in your brilliant performance on that at Jimmy's, we have to stop being nice. And people somehow
think, I have to stop being nice.
Yeah.
I mean, but that doesn't mean, so what I'm saying is I understand, yes, the people at the top of the food chain in my party have to practice civility. But as Roosevelt said to the labor unions, make me do it. And Hillary, who I voted for, said, make me do it. You have to have people like me who are never going to rise up through the food chain and become, you know, a leading Democrat. You need people like me who understand the importance of civility but aren't civil.
Yeah, no, because
you have to scare the people who are civil in our party to move further and further to the
absolutely
left.
And so
you need an angry base like me.
But I don't think we need to boo the vice president in the theater.
Yes, you do. Oh, absolutely.
But if you do everything else, okay. But there are a lot of lazy people go, hey, I booed him, or I posted something on Facebook, my job is done. So
I would have screamed F you.
All right. Well, again, my initial reaction when I heard it, I admit, there was glee. I remember seeing Paul Wolfowitz interviewed at the News School right after the invasion of Iraq.
War criminal.
And someone yelled out, you Nazi, you're a Nazi. And
good.
Yeah, I was happy to hear it. So I have a lot of emotions there.
Remember at the White House Correspondents' Dinner, some woman, and it wasn't Medea Benjamin, somebody got right up in Donald Rumsfeld's face, Secretary of Defense. I have to find the video. I'll post it on my website. War criminal! War criminal! War criminal! And both her hands were up. Mm-hmm. It was brilliant. So you knew she wasn't holding anything.
Yeah.
War
yeah.
criminal! War! And there. And he was the Secretary of Defense at the time. People are dying, and he's coming for a few laughs at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. And she's screaming war criminal in his face. And his bodyguards are going, well, yeah, she's kind of right. And they didn't, they let
she's
her
wearing
scream.
Pink, it's okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And because there was nothing in her hand, go ahead.
Yeah, no, and look, I again, and then also just the other thing of, I question, okay, 48 million people didn't vote. And I will say now, anyone who
really did, is it that?
I think that was the number. And anyone who didn't vote for Hillary Clinton is responsible for Donald Trump. And as you were talking about Wisconsin and Michigan, Wisconsin, Jill Stein got 30,000 votes, more than a margin of victory Trump had. Michigan, her vote total is more than the margin of victory. I'm all for third parties, and it should be stronger third parties. But this whole idea now, oh, let's get one of the electoral look, that would have rioting in the streets. And again, if Hillary won, I wouldn't want Trump supporters marching because they'd be armed. And if Hillary won, I wouldn't want people going, let's fiddle around with the Electoral College. So, again, let's work within the system that we have vigorously. Let's move the Democratic Party further left because I think that's the way to bring in the to connect. You know, I remember during the election, people saying, oh, Bernie, it's all that all he talks about is 1%. Well, that's all anyone should have been talking about. Mm-hmm. And he would have been able to connect. There are very few liberals who've been able to do what Bernie can. Mario Cuomo was someone who could connect to the quote unquote common man, but still with a very progressive agenda. Right. Jesse Jackson, who has been cast away, who I was with you in 84 at the convention, never seen a more powerful speech. Yeah. Hillary would have been a great president. She didn't have that ability to connect on that level and express that message. So
let's get back to Hamilton.
Yeah.
Here's why Mr. Pence, somebody should have screamed F you to him. And I'm disappointed with New York theater goers for not screaming F you. The problem is that was filled with a lot of one percenters.
Well, also, you feel like if you yell F you get kicked out, and it was $200 waiting a year for tickets. So, but they did boo. I mean, some people.
Well,
did
they
boo.
Should have screamed F you, and because he's in a bubble, and he is doing something that is sinful that white people tend to do. They appropriate the black culture, the Puerto Rican culture, for their own benefit. If you're Mike Pence, you don't get to enjoy Hamilton. I was hanging out outside. I was working on a show. And we were outside the Hilton interviewing Trump supporters and the night of the victory. Uh-huh. And there were young men walking around in Beatles T-shirts. And if you voted for Trump, you don't get to wear a Beatles T-shirt. If you're Lee Atwater or Mike Huckabee, you don't get to play rock and roll. You don't get to appropriate the music of the black man, of the Delta, that got appropriated by the white man, who was mostly, if you go back and look at rock and roll, that music opposes everything you represent. When it was sung by a black man or later appropriated by a white man, that music was about sex and dancing, which Mike Pence is against. He's against dancing and sex. You don't get to have the Beatles. You don't get to have the Who. And Mick Jagger, who went to the London School of Economics, is it train in vain? You can't always get what you want. Why is that? Yeah. That's not train in vain. Well, I don't know what I blocked it out right now. Why are the Rolling Stones allowing Donald Trump to play their music at the end of his rallies?
I bet they probably aren't, but he doesn't listen to them. And although it is apropos, you can't really get what you want, and they're not going to get what they want.
Well, hang on for one second.
I think everybody else,
John Mellencamp, Bruce Springsteen, they all said, stop playing my music. Not the Rolling Stones. What does that say about Mick Jagger with his degree from the London School of Economics? No, so Hamilton, if you're Mike Pence, You don't get to come into New York City, which you hate, and get to see Puerto Ricans, blacks, and LGBT performers and enjoy their work and have a little of that good karma rub off on you. You don't get that. You don't get that. You appeal to the ignorant fly under states. I call them the fly under states. You don't get to enjoy Broadway. You've lost the right to enjoy Broadway because you're Mike Pence and you're a racist, and there are Muslims now who are living in fear in this country. There are Hispanics who are living in fear in this country. So when you boo Mike Pence, and that is blasted on the internet and everybody gets to see that, that says to the Muslims and the Latinos and Hispanics in this country, we're on your side. You cannot give these people any quarter. You cannot give Trump and Pence an inch. You have to fight them every step of the way. They need to know that we reject them, because it helps the frightened Muslim, Arab, Hispanic child who is terrified right now. Do you know what I'm making a joke here. I think I came up with a joke. Do you know what my son, my 5-year-old son, said to me yesterday? Daddy, are we going to have to round up all the Hispanics in Mexico? And I said, not yet, son. Yeah, right.
How will I get my homework done?
My son is now afraid. Yeah. Can I do this? Hang on, I'm working on it.
Sure, sure. Okay.
My son is afraid that he's going to have to round up his Arab and Mexican friends. He's terrified that he's not going to be able to play his video games and watch his television. I said, don't worry, son. You're not going to have to. They have people who do that. You don't have to. Anyway.
Yeah. No. And again.
Is that funny?
No, I think it's very funny. And look, as you said, and ties in earlier, I can't imagine what it's like being.
Hang on for a minute. Can you make a note? I'm going to try that. Are you so nice? And I'm horrible. But can you make a note on that, please? Did you make a note? I'm sorry. And there were two jokes I did last night that I forgot. Anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I just say, again, I can't imagine, obviously, what it's like being Muslim or an immigrant in this country or LGBT. You know, it's got to be frightening and what the prospect is. I guess, you know, maybe I'm old school. Maybe it's sort of like, you know, all right, the guy's sitting in the theater, but let's give them hell every other way and legislatively.
We're not
going to.
You're not going to. We're going to be put in cages, not literal cages. You remember the Republican convention in 2004. If you wanted to protest George W. Bush, we were caged off at the convention. You're not. They don't. They're in a bubble. So he was out of his bubble, Mike Pence.
But let me. I'll ask you this. And you said eloquently, there are people we need to reach to bring over. Now, obviously, Mike Pence is not going to become a progressive Democrat. But if he has the ear of the president, is there any way to reach out to Mike Pence in any way? And first of all, look,
He's worse than.
Well,
Trump.
He is in some ways. Look, I'm appalled by everything he stands for. I would say, and this is does not take away from the other horrible things. When Trump announced the Muslim ban, Pence did speak up against that, not to give him any credit in any other way. So I guess what I'm saying is maybe some people think if I just boo, that's all it takes. Like if Hitler got booed and going to the theater in Germany with the Holocaust have happened. So, I think that we just need to fight on every level. And I do question, as much as dissent is great, the demonstrations now, we're protesting an election result. You know, many of those people didn't vote for Hillary Clinton. That was at the time the protest was before. I hope they're out there when Roe v. Wade is at risk, when Affordable Care Act is at risk, when immigration is at risk, when there's a lot of horrible things that were going to happen with any Republican.
Yeah.
And now we do have the specter of an anti-Semite white nationalist with Trump's ear, and a lot of horrible things and the unpredictability. And as a comedian, and other people said this, to me, the most shocking thing is, and again, I think everyone who voted for Trump there's a degree of ignorance. They're not all bad people, and they're certainly not all racist, but the ignorance that a fake rich guy could come along who says, I'm going to bring back your jobs, and they believed it, looking at the fake news sites, they bear responsibility, and it is ignorance. And I feel sorry for them, because they're going to be the first ones to be disappointed and to be hurt. And that will be the opportunity from the left when those people turn, when they see Trump couldn't care less. And he makes – talk about fake news. Trump said yesterday, Bill Ford, the head of Ford called me to say we're not moving our plant to – Lincoln plant to Mexico. They were never moving the plant. So he took something that was never going to happen to take credit for it. So
let me go back to – how many people didn't vote?
I read 48 million. I mean, maybe
that's just unconscionable.
Yeah.
And I know somebody who I love very much who didn't vote. I met Congressman Lewis. Mm. I had a picture taken with him. Kanye said he didn't vote.
Right.
But had he voted, he would have voted for Trump. And he doesn't speak for all African Americans, and he's free to go make his money, and he can be anybody he wants to be. But if I am correct, and we're going to try to get Greg Palast on the show. Mm. A lot of African Americans tried to vote once again, and they couldn't. They're still scrubbing the voter rolls, and the Supreme Court pretty much overturned, I think it was 2 years ago, provisions in the Civil Rights Act of 64 or 65.
The Voting Rights Act.
The Voting Rights Act that pretty much gave the worst states in our union freedom to do whatever they want with black people vis-a-vis voting. So black people had trouble voting. Poor people have trouble voting. There are it's hard to – you have to wait in line longer if you're poor. And – there's a lot of voter suppression. That's really how Trump won.
Yeah.
Because in the swing states, if people were allowed to vote, he would have lost. So those votes are out there. We just can't get those people to the polls. If you're a privileged white liberal and you couldn't make it to the polls in a swing state, it's on you.
Right.
That's on you. Because black people, and I'm not being, I mean, this is true.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, and that gets back to the point earlier, you know, what people say, oh, here's another Hitler. The road to fascism has been going on a long time with the Republican Party. Like you said, disenfranchising people. Their only goal is to stop Democratic voters. So that's fascism. That's anti-democratic. And you know what Sean Hannity said the other day, that CNN should be denied White House credentials because they were biased. This is coming from Sean Hannity, who works at Fox, who also worked for the Trump campaign. So that's a real thing to be worried about.
Let's talk about this. Is you're going to rise much higher in the Democratic Party than I am, and you're going to rise much higher in the Jewish community.
Well, not in the Orthodox Jewish community, because they voted for Trump, but
yes, which puts to rest finally the ugly stereotype that all Jews are smart.
Right.
I'll talk to you about the Jewish stuff in a second. You know, I'm against identity politics unless you're going to use it for your own good. I think as a Jew, and I do speak for 80% of all Jews in America. I do. I reflect. I do. I speak for what? I do. I am the voice of 80% of what I believe. 80% of American Jews believe, as do you. Hey, you're a little too sweet. Are you a Zionist?
I don't use that term. I mean, I believe in a two-state solution, and I love your...
Me too.
Yeah.
I believe in it for America, California, New York.
Which is the way we think we're going. I think that... You know, sadly, the Zionist Organization of America, and this seems like an Onion headline, is honoring Steve Bannon tomorrow night.
Who is?
The Zionist Organization of America is honoring Steve Bannon, an anti-Semite and a white nationalist. So,
who said he didn't want to send his daughter to a private school because
these are the good Jews. Yeah, these are the good Jews.
Where
and
is
I'm
this,
the bad Jew.
Where is
it's
this?
It's going to be in Manhattan at some fancy hotel. I don't know where. Follow the demonstrators, hopefully.
The only reason Steve Bannon is a fan of Israel is he hates Palestinians more than he hates Jews. He's got his own little rung of mud people, and the Jews are a little higher on the ladder than the Palestinians.
Oh, yeah, and Jews have to realize that even the evangelicals, they don't love Jews. The believe in the rapture is that the Jews have to be in control, and then they kick them out, and then the Christians take over. So, you know, any Jewish person who could vote for Republicans or could support Steve Bannon is not voting in their own interests.
The evangelicals, the right wing, views Israel the same way James Monroe viewed Liberia. James Monroe, President Monroe, was an inveterate racist who just believed blacks had no place in America. We send them all back to Liberia. So, you know, hence Monrovia, is that the capital of Liberia?
Right.
James Monroe. You don't want the black people in America. Send them to Liberia. Hence the name Liberia, liberty, freedom for black people, just not here. That's what Israel is to these people. That's what these Orthodox Jews don't understand. They don't want you here. They want you in Israel.
Sadly, they'll be the first ones targeted if there's going to be targeted because they're obvious targets. So it's troubling. It used to be 77% of Jews voted Democratic.
So
I mean, you should see what those figures are.
Yeah, if you're a Jew, I don't believe in identity politics. I have picked up this. And by the way, this is a podcast. This is not a radio show or a television show. This is like the underground where I can talk freely and manufacture dissent, smart. I don't have to be, you know, I can be a little devious with my listeners, especially since we're deep into the show and now we have like the inveterate fans of the show. If you're Jewish, I don't believe in identity politics, but I've noticed that the right wing is afraid of Jews. Even Steve Bannon is afraid of Jews because they're prejudiced and they believe in Zog. They believe in the protocols of the elders of Zion. They believe that there is this conspiracy out there. I have talked to right-wing bigots who are terrified that I'm going to accuse them of anti-Semitism because, A, they are anti-Semitic and they don't want to be found out, and, B, they're anti-Semitic because they think we're controlling everything. So if you're a left-wing Jew, you might cautiously want to really stay on this Bannon, the Steve Bannon thing. You should not let go of calling Steve Bannon an anti-Semite.
Absolutely.
And just keep hammering it. If you're a Jew, just keep hammering the Steve Bannon issue over and over and over again. It's identity politics. I don't approve of it. But what it does is it scares the hell out of Trump. And it scares the hell out of the right wing because they do not want to be accused of anti-Semitism. They're afraid of Jews, the right wing, it's so much that they hate them. So if you're a Catholic, this is deep in the weeds, evil shit that I don't approve of. Mike Pence is a Roman Catholic. He was inspired by John F. Kennedy. That's why he went into politics. And Martin Luther King. He's very religious. I don't approve of identity politics. But if you're like me, I'm an evil Jew. If we have any evil Roman Catholics out there, you need to hold Mike Pence's feet to the fire. Listen to Nuns on the Bus and our Pope and remind Mike Pence every step of the way what the Pope says. Constantly harangue Mike Pence. Remind him of what our Pope, he's my Pope. He is. I love my Pope. And I know Barry Crimmins, you know, I do hero work. I could become a Catholic, by the way.
This is the perfect pope to start. Yeah.
Remind Mike Pence every day what his pope teaches. Go ahead.
Yeah, by the same token, absolutely. And there'll be some people who say, oh, Catholic bashing. No, Mike Pence is not a true Catholic. If he harbors all this hatred to gay people and others, that's not what Jesus stood for. And John Fugelsang and Catholics say that much better than I can. But I can speak for Jews who claim to be so devout, and yet they're also homophobic, or they're also discriminatory towards Palestinians and Muslims. That's not what Judaism is all about either. It truly should be about compassion for all, and that's what I try to live my life in my own flawed way.
Yeah. And for Thanksgiving, here's the secret to having a peaceful Thanksgiving. Be alone on Thanksgiving.
Or just eat a lot so you're so bloated you can't argue.
Yeah, yeah. I'm going to get to your Facebook and Twitter feuds and Thanksgiving. This is my advice.
Okay.
We have to stop having these Manichaean conversations, dividing the world into good and evil, one and two. I was talking to Judah Grunstein, who's a journalist, lives in Paris. I was talking to one of my kids who's living in Germany. There's nuance overseas. You have various parties. You know, the parliamentary system is not Manichaean. You have to build coalitions, and there's nuance to belief systems. That's why there are people like Norman Ornstein from the American Enterprise Institute who is tweeting against Trump, but even though he's a right-wing douchebag who would probably be a Democrat and a liberal if he were really smart and could make money off their think tanks. I mean, what you have, like somebody like Norman Ornstein really is a liberal at heart, but he just doesn't have the intellectual muster to get on the left-wing payroll, so he has to be the moderate.
Well, that's a troubling thing too, and this is a much longer conversation, but you know, again, if we want to make the change and stop the horrible things from happening, first of all, we need to get to the point, as you said, when we were growing up, not to say it was perfect, but it was Walter Cronkite, it was the three networks, and nobody disagreed what the news was. No one said, this is no Vietnam. You know, we accepted what it was, and then we had different points of view. And people should watch Mort Saul on YouTube. He did a brilliant bit. It
was the best.
On the Hollywood Palace, which is incredible. Can you imagine today, any of us getting on a mainstream show like that, about how there's like 9 or 10 different parts of the political spectrum. So, and this whole, we're not going to get anywhere. It's like you liberals or libtards, as people call them, or you conservatives, or you this. It's childish. It's sort of like the red team, the blue, and we're not going to, get anywhere with that. And also, we're not going to get anywhere if CNN and all these other networks, it's all pundits. Pundits, as you said, are all people looking where the money is. It's like, frankly, I think Donald Trump would have run as a Democrat if he thought he had an easier path. He has no core beliefs except himself. And the pundits, it's not learning. We need to learn. I need to learn. I want to learn all the time. And I will throw in another thing. You know what this reminds me of, having gone through breakups, as both of us have, as everybody listening has? It's a very similar dynamic. If you're talking to, politics is not different than talking to a woman or talking to a friend. If you're going to connect, you can't go, you never listen to me. Why are you being so defensive? You people do that. Does that conversation ever get anywhere? So we need to find a place somehow where we can talk. And as you said, there are people we could talk to. The racists, the bigots, the anti-Semites, no, we can't. But there's plenty of others we can. And I'm trying to learn in my personal life every day and in other ways, and I don't want to get into yelling matches on Facebook.
I'll tell you right now. I stopped years ago on Facebook and Twitter getting into it with people.
And I usually do, and then there are moments where it's just, let me just express it, and it never goes well because, it's not a world. If it was like, oh, thank you, Scott, interesting point. I do take, as you speak, no one speaks like you, David. So if it was that, it would be pleasure. And yet, and I tremble. I'm not one of those people. I don't know how people like Dean, who I love, Dean Obadala, all these people fight on Twitter all day. I get wounded so easily by one thing.
Why does that accomplish?
It accomplishes nothing, and I just wanted to express it. It was a waste of time, frankly.
I actually, there's a listener named Jordan Burke. If you go to my Facebook, not the fan page, but if you friend me on Facebook, I actually had an exchange with a listener named Jordan Burke who was trolling my friends and provoking them. And I actually got him to confess that he's really just messing with people. He would get all my friends. This isn't my show has a fan page, but if you're my friend on Facebook, he was baiting my friends. And I said, stop. I said to my friends on Facebook, stop falling for him. I'm using him as the canary in the coal mine now. If you actually take his bait, I'm going to unfriend you because I don't want friends who bother fighting.
Or write long responses.
You know, it's one thing to write a long response. And if fighting with people provokes you to write this long response, copy that response and post it as your own voice on Facebook. Don't argue. Maybe, I don't know, maybe some people like it. Maybe it's fuel. You know what? Maybe I'm wrong. I have this show and I, you know, if fighting with people on Facebook solidifies certain beliefs for you and helps you arrive at some ideas, maybe it is a valuable thing. I have my own outlets. Maybe fighting with people on Facebook.
Well, maybe that's all they have. But it's as you said, it's never productive.
I
don't think it would be productive again if you had people. And if there was any chance of learning, and let me tell you something, I used to do FoxNews.com live a lot. I was on Fox News. I'd like to get back on. I'd open my mind because I remember the first time I was on, and I'm going, oh, these conservatives, and this guy, David Webb, is a very smart guy, has shown serious conservative. He said, and FDR was packing the court, and in my sanctimony, I go, oh, come on. Packing the court. And I went home and I said to my dad, there was this guy who said FDR packed the court. My dad said, oh, no, he did try to pack the court. Mm-hmm. So I immediately went to the assumption that they're all making stuff up. So I learned something from that. But I would say that Facebook fighting, first of all, it's mean. It's cutting. It makes me feel bad. And 99.9% of the people are not trying to learn something or trying to illuminate. They're trying to be mean. And there's even one stand-up comic who seems – attacked me, I think it was me today, sort of, you know, from just a just as I didn't think we should have booed. Okay, disagree with me. I couldn't care less. First, I guess the question is, why should I care? You know, I care what you think because I respect you and your friend. Why should I care what these people think? But yeah. I do.
I'm not gonna plug this company because I don't know if they're on the up and up, but I use them. I read about this company that says it'll help you save money by every transaction you make with a credit card, they round it off. So let's say you buy a New York Times for what is the new, I subscribe. So let's say it's $2.50 and you put it on your credit card, right? Or your debit card, they will round off the difference and put 50 cents into a savings account for you. So every time you're spending money, you're saving money.
Oh, wow.
It's called roundups. That's not the name of the company. I'm not endorsing them, but I'm making a point. So anytime I spend money, psychologically, I'm saving money because I know that they're rounding it off to the nearest dollar and putting that into a savings account. The name of the company is Acorn. I don't know if they're on the up and up, but it's kind of interesting to me that I go to Starbucks, it comes to $1.80, I give them my credit card, can I talk a little more Jewishly, 20 cents goes into a save. I buy a cup of coffee for $1.80 and 20 cents goes
this
into.
This is like the best idea I've heard in years.
Well, I don't want to endorse this company. Because I'm not sure that they're on the up and up. And they charge $1 a month to do this. So that's $12 a year. The point I'm making is it's painful for me to spend money. Gone through wrapping up a divorce.
Yeah.
It's painful to spend money. So at least I have a sense this falls that I'm saving money when I'm spending money So next time you get angry at somebody on Twitter, instead of responding, send money to the ACLU. Give money to Planned Parenthood. $1.50
That's excellent advice.
A nickel. There, you know, you could, if you have, you can do that. You can send St. Jude's Hospital, which doesn't turn them away. Mm. That was Robin Williams' charity.
Right.
And I didn't know that St. Jude's, I've always been, never trusted any, you know, turns out St. Jude's is like the real deal. So when you get angry, depends on how angry you are. If you're really angry, give money to Planned Parenthood. If you're loving, give money to St. Jude's. Give a nickel. Give a dollar.
Maybe that could be a business model for Facebook, that in order to comment a certain way, each comment actually becomes a donation to, if it's a political thing or something, or
yeah.
I don't know, haven't quite fleshed it out, but, or if it's an angry comment, it automatically
yeah.
goes to Planned Parenthood, you know.
And you know, I have these conversations with my kids about money. You know, there's a stereotype that Jews are good with money, and it's unfair, but the Talmud in many ways is about money and the responsibility that you have with money. That you know, people say vote with your wallet. Jews can be good with money. Good as in good, not like, you know, getting rich. Mm-hmm. I will say to my kids, yes, we are good with money. If you read the Talmud, you're good with money. Not good with money, good with money. And I recommend to our listeners that you be good with your money. Before you spend it, ask yourself, am I being good with this money? Do I need this Big Mac, which is destroying the planet? Or should I give somebody a subscription to the New York Times? Be good with money. Yeah. So arguing at Thanksgiving, if you want to make somebody's head explode, tell them you don't like Hillary Clinton. If you have a right-wing friend, don't let them hijack the conversation by saying, well, Hillary did this. Find out what they believe. Their heads explode, because you can really pick off the ignorant, hateful people. A lot of these people went to the Republican Party because they need psychiatric help. No, I'm serious. I know a lot of people who have, like, are impotent, hateful, and they said, oh, wait a second, I'm not a deviant. I'm a Republican. Ask these people what they want. Don't fight with them. Ask them, do you think poor people should be helped? Ask them questions. Don't fight. How do we help poor people? Okay, so you don't have health insurance. If these people are too irresponsible to get a job, do we just let them die? Keep digging down. Don't fight. Don't argue. Ask them questions. I've done this in front of my son, and he goes, oh, my God. I almost got punched. We ran into a friend who's a lawyer who was, you know, watches Fox News. I just said, so what do we do about these people? So what's the answer? So they die? And the guy almost started to cry, and then he wanted to punch me. Don't argue. Ask them what they believe.
Absolutely. Well, can I say, I do that. I have done it on occasion. I have conservative friends, and sometimes I'll drop into a conversation, which is a fascinating thing. Sort of like, who's this alien? Like, everybody's bashing, and I'll just go, oh, hey, I'm curious, what corrupt thing did Hillary do? Or something specific. and there's a lot of fumfering. Wow, they all. Oh no, I'm just curious what you refer, and even to put it in that tone, even though I'm not speaking, right. I'm writing it, and because that's what fuels everything. And even on the left, there's this whole thing. Oh, they do this, and you say, oh, okay, what would be one example of that? And people can answer, and that's what we need. Look,
but even that's getting into that Manichaean us versus them, dividing the world into two. I think we go for more nuance and say, well, forget Hillary Clinton. Forget that election. I agree with you. She's a flawed candidate. I was compromising. What are we going to do about the environment? What are we going to – do you believe global – so you're okay with climate change. Just find out what they believe.
Yeah, yeah. Or you got kids. Do you worry at all what kind of world it might be like?
I mean, we're sharing the – Yeah, but fighting feels good. It gets your juices going. I love being angry.
Yeah,
I don't like being hateful, but I love being angry.
Yeah, I wish I did more. Excuse me, but I remember once I literally felt I pulled a muscle for that. So I think I was always the one growing up like, oh, don't fight, but I'm passionate and I want to express myself, but I guess I'm not ready for what follows. On Facebook, so that's what I have to say.
Anger is this great motivation. I believe, and I've said this to my daughters and female friends, that anger is sacred. It's a weapon. It energizes you. It's more powerful than coffee. And women have a right to be angry. I used to say this to my younger daughters. Your anger is sacred. Channel it into something that will move us forward. So anger is great. Fighting with a Republican, it's a fool's errand, I think.
Especially if you're just doing talking points back and forth.
I'd rather be angry at you because I think we can arrive at something. But anger is great. I channel it into this show, into stand-up, into writing jokes. Before we wrap it up, Alex is ready to kill me. Jeff Sessions, is he going to be Attorney General?
I think there's going to be a lot of pushback. He was rejected in '86 for judgeship.
In '86, he had used the N-word and joked about the Ku Klux Klan, saying he thought they were okay until he learned that they smoked marijuana. That's a funny joke.
Yeah.
But he called a black. See, that's the danger of joking.
Yeah.
It's a funny joke. But then he's also been accused of calling an African-American assistant U.S. attorney boy.
Right, right.
And calling the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People un-American and communist-inspired. I've talked about this on the show.
Yeah.
That when comedians offend, there's truth to a joke. That joke is funny about the marijuana.
Yeah.
But it belies something else. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, look, Sessions, he'd be troubling for a lot of reasons. He's a hard right guy. He is liked in the Senate. And I guess, all I can hope for is these reprehensible comments that he made. Republicans always bring up, if I would write something about Sessions, well, how about Robert Byrd?
Right.
And that's an example. Yes, as a teenager, he was in the KKK, and he turned out to be one of the most esteemed senators around. He changed. He was horrible as a teenager and changed.
Right.
Has Sessions changed? I don't know. Does he still feel that? If he does, it's irreprehensible and he shouldn't be attorney general. If there's some redeeming value there, he's obviously someone we don't stand for a million other reasons. So that has to
Should
to
he
save.
Be the attorney general?
I wish he wasn't, but whoever it's going to be is going to be someone we don't like.
We're going from Loretta Lynch.
Right.
To a guy.
And
who,
Eric Holder. Yeah, it's
Let me do my joke. We're going from Loretta Lynch to I want a Lynch.
Right.
I just made that up. That's a great joke. Can you write that down? God,
that is great. That I'm sorry that I stepped on that.
And nothing like trivializing lynching, which it was,
But in a catchy way.
Yeah. I mean, if I were a black person listening, I go, really? You really think that's funny? Lynching, that's another thing that we have to learn. The word lynch, not a funny word.
No.
It used to be.
And lynch mob should only be used in reference to lynch mobs, not something benign.
Mike Pompeo, CIA, 52. He's been nominated to head the CIA.
He wants to keep Guantanamo Bay open. And he said he looked at some of the inmates who were declaring a hunger strike, and they're still being force-fed, and he said they look like they put on weight. He made a little joke about these guys.
Well, you know what? This is the problem we have. They're all going to be horrible. Like, that's why if Romney is Secretary of State, it'll be like hallelujah, not Giuliani, who's the most undiplomatic person on the face of the earth. I wish he was in the mold of Romney, who I clearly disagree with, but I feel like he's a decent human being who, not horrible. I think these choices are going to, whatever Republican, if it was Ted Cruz, we'd have horrible choices. The guy, Pompey, is it Pompey or we're living through Pompey, whatever it is. The Benghazi craziness for 4 years.
You block, you stones, you less than curious things, knew you not Pompey. Was that from Julius Caesar or something? Pompey was like one of the, the triumvirate who was, I have to read my Shakespeare.
Yeah, no, they're bad. Michael Flynn, is it Flynn? He's bad. He said very anti-Muslim things. He has a horrible attitude to ISIS, and he's the type like
we'll
Trump
go through them.
Encouraging terrorism.
We have to wrap it up. I know that. But let me just say this about Mike Pompeo, or Pompeo. Pompeo, draining the swamp, right? Mm. I'm going to drain the swamp. Rand Paul, if you're listening, the head of the CIA, defends the National Security Agency's bulk data collection program. So
Rand Paul's actually spoken out against Flynn and Pompeo, and hopefully he'll fight it. And hopefully the one little silver lining, and you spoke beautifully about this months ago, and maybe it's wishful thinking, but if Trump can cause either destruction of the Republican Party as we know it or realignment, and maybe there will be dissension within the party with people like Rand Paul. So we could hope for that, too. It's not just from the Democrats.
Mike Flynn, National Security Advisor. That's a post that is not approved by the Senate. You get to be National Security Advisor based on the president's wishes. And you end up becoming the most important foreign policy advisor to the president because there's no congressional scrutiny. You know, Condoleezza Rice was George W. Bush's national security advisor. When she got tired, then they moved her over to state. Henry Kissinger was first the national security advisor under Nixon, and he had all the power because he didn't have to be approved by Congress. And what was his name? Who was the secretary of state under Nixon? God damn it. Rogers. Was it Rogers? Let me look it up. Who just became a sinecure, and then Henry got tired, and he became both Secretary of State and National Security Advisor because Secretary of State, William Pierce Rogers, who just had nothing to do because Kissinger is running the show because he didn't have to be approved by Congress. Pay attention to who the National Security Advisor is. That's where all the power in foreign policy is. And Michael Flynn is going to be appointed National Security Advisor, and he's the one who's going to determine whether or not we go to war. That's the guy. The National Security, Condi Rice. The Secretary of State is cosmetic. I want Romney. You know, Rachel Maddow was criticizing, I'm wrapping it up, Rachel Maddow was criticizing Romney for, he's going to take the job. I hope he takes
Absolutely.
The job.
Compared to these others, he's...
But it's a cosmetic, it's cosmetic.
They travel, they should get the frequent flyer miles, that's what I would want.
Let's hope he's a better Secretary of State than that piece of dung, Colin Powell. Colin Powell's a piece of dung who rolled over and let Iraq happen. And he still gets $100,000 to deliver motivational speeches, like the motivational speech he gave at the UN holding up the vial of talcum powder, warning us about anthrax. Secretary of State, if you're going to be Secretary of State, have the courage of your convictions to walk away from the post, which Colin Powell didn't.
Yeah, and I just very quickly, as we have to wrap up, these examples you're giving, and there's many, many more, this is what I say to the liberals, the far left, who said, there's no difference between Hillary and Trump. They're both evil. This is evil, what you're talking about. These are horrible people who are going to hurt our country. And anybody who didn't support Hillary Clinton is enabling people like these names you're giving us.
Okay. And just so Michael Flynn, who's going to be the national security advisor, he's a Democrat, fired by Obama, has tweeted fears of Muslims is rational. Fears of Muslims.
Yeah, and Sharia law and all that.
Yeah, he says Sharia law. Yeah. So that's who's going
to... He's a crackpot. He's an extremist. And he's going to be the number one foreign policy advisor.
Okay. And just so you know, Stephen Mnuchin, Treasury Secretary, 17 years at Goldman Sachs. Yeah, you really drained the swamp there. Let's see. Who else? There was... One other people. Good grammar there. Jared Kushner. If you're Jewish.
He's going to be Secretary of Nepotism.
Secretary of Nepotism. Went to Harvard. According to Daniel Golden, author of The Price of Admissions, How America's Ruling Class Buys Its Way into Elite Colleges... Jared Kushner did not have the grades to get into Harvard, but Charles Kushner, the dad, donated $2.5 million to Harvard the year Jared Kushner applied to Harvard. Donald Trump Jr. kills elephants, an endangered species. Eric hunts endangered species. Give them nothing. Give them nothing. If Donald Trump declares a $3 trillion moonshot to cure cancer, tell him to shove it up his ass. Give this administration nothing. Give them nothing. Scott Blakeman. ScottBlakeman.com, laughing liberally. Follow Scott on Twitter. It is an honor to have you on the show. I wish we had more time. I really do.
Such great spending time with you, David. Thank you so much.
Time now for our listener of the week. He comes to us from Austin, Texas. Roni Kobrosly. Did I pronounce Roni correctly?
Yeah.
Because I don't care about Kobrosly. I really don't. Scott Blakeman's here. Say hi, Scott.
Hi. How's it going?
Hi, Roni.
And you're from Austin, Texas. Today, you're calling us from Austin, Texas.
That's right. Yeah.
So last week, I asked our listeners to protest, but I also asked them to get involved. And you said you contacted us. You said you tried to get involved. And it was hard.
Yeah. I'm a statistician and a data scientist, and I thought this would be a great time to contribute those skills towards politicians that could maybe use that, you know, look at their data and get some advantage some way. And it turns out it's a little bit difficult to send cold emails to the DNC or Texas Democrats and get their attention. So I figured, you know, you know Ralph Nader, and you know Howie Klein and these people, and maybe you would know someone that could connect me.
And you're offering your services for a fee?
No, just totally free. I'd love to just help out. And
I think that's your problem. Seriously.
I a friend of mine actually said that. They said people tend to take you more seriously if you work for them rather than just volunteer. So you might be right about that.
Well, why don't we do this? This is kind of interesting to me because the Clinton wing of the party has died. And I would go to Elizabeth Warren because she addresses the financial issues in this country and the Democratic Party. The idea of somebody volunteering in this culture is alien. People use politics to make money. It's all about making money. So they don't understand. If you say to somebody, can I ask you how old you are, Roni?
Yeah, I'm 32.
Okay, well, that's interesting. There was a time when people got involved in politics because they cared about the future of the country. Now, politics is, it doesn't matter who wins. It's about getting rich. That's...
Yeah.
So
it's hard to argue with that.
Yeah, so there was a listener who came to our ACLU benefit last night, which you should have been... Why weren't you there?
I would have.
I left New York a few months ago.
No, I was talking to Scott Blakeman. I'm glad you weren't there, Roni. Roni, I was glad... No offense, but I was really glad. I'm just.
Yeah, right. It was a great show. I'll do another one. I thought, can I tell you something?
Yeah, go ahead.
As I said, how great it was. I was about to eat a coaster. That's how hungry I am.
Oh, wow.
They're
crackers.
A sugared cookie. No, it's fine.
By the way, this is why I'm not number one on iTunes, Scott, right. Because Roni is just this great, sweet, caring human being. And I'm fighting every instinct in my body just to attack him because he seems to like me. So you listen to my show, right?
I do, yeah.
So what is my urge to want to smack you around? What's wrong with me that I don't say I love you and thank you? Instead, I just want to humiliate you. What does that say about me?
I think that's your comedic instinct. I don't know.
What does it say about me that I want to eat a cookie that's actually just a coaster? So we learn so much about each other,
yes.
Don't we?
So one of the listeners of the show, I think his name is Stephen Claremont. Maybe I am violating a trust here by saying his name. But I got to meet one of our listeners, and he came to the benefit for the ACLU. And he said to me, Nancy Pelosi, I've seen her office. It's pretty nice. If you're in the minority in the House, you get a nice, pretty office. It's not going to get any nicer if you're the Speaker. There's no motivation to win. It's okay to be on the outside pissing into the tent. In fact, it's a lot more fun. He didn't say this, but, it's one of the things I said about Yasser Arafat was, it's much easier to be a victim than have to worry about the garbage getting collected. So there's a lot of money to be made being a victim or being on the outside. There's no motivation to actually govern. So I think that's what you're up against, in that there's a whole political class now in Washington, D.C. and in Austin, that's your state capital, where people make money off politics. There's a lot, Les Moonves, the head of CBS, said Trump is great for our bottom line, all this political advertising. So you've offered your services for free to the Democratic Party, right?
Yeah.
Who did you plan? Name names.
Name names.
I think we should do an experiment here. You have a PhD in data collection.
Well, data science, yeah.
Data science. Well, we have a new CIA director who might be interested in hiring you.
Oh, God.
What is data science? Big data, right?
Yeah, it's big data. It's everything on one end of the spectrum from, which includes visualizing data, telling a story with it, to the other end, which is the magic that Google's doing with AI and processing massive amounts of data, making a universal translator, all these wonderful things. Yeah.
So I have listeners. If I wanted you to do big data on my listeners, what would you do? Like, if I wanted to find out, where they live, what time they drop their kid off at school, what time I could kidnap their child and hold my child for ransom. Could you help me with that?
I took a course on that, David.
How much can you dig down deep? What could you tell me about my listeners, and how would you find that out?
Well, it depends on what kind of data you have on them. Does iTunes give you any information about where your subscribers are coming from or their IP addresses or things like that? I don't know. It just depends what you have, really.
No.
No? If you had that kind of info, you can tell a lot. You can
I'm just
tell where they are. You can estimate their income. You can kind of estimate all these like scary and amazing things from that.
Women who swallow.
Yeah.
Is that?
Yeah.
Does that come?
Yeah.
I also
took a class in grad school. Yeah.
What would they have on me? Forget my listeners. I'm worried about me. What if I listen to Rachel Maddow as a podcast or Amy Goodman as a podcast? What could they know about me?
I mean, it's tough to say without knowing the raw data they have, but I imagine they could probably, you know, they could construct this pretty elaborate profile on you. I mean, nothing too precise, maybe not your street address or things like that, but they can get a pretty good profile, you know, based on just a few bits of information.
Based on iTunes information?
I would think. I mean, I think, I don't know iTunes specifically, but, you know, if you're able to get someone's IP address and...
What does IP address mean? Is that my toilet? Get it? My IP address? Is that different
exactly.
from... Hang on, let me...
No,
I'm not done yet. Hang on.
You're sort of...
Hang on, I'm not done yet. I have another stupid joke to make.
Let's hear it.
This is for the two-year-olds who are listening. And is there an IPoo address? Okay. Aren't you glad you called an IP address? And IP? What does IP address mean?
It's sort of like your origin on the internet, you know, where you're accessing things from.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But does
not
it,
very funny.
Hang on. Is an IP address would mean... Like the neighborhood or the specific, like the router?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's associated with your router, and it's associated with, you know, it's provided to you by your internet service provider.
Hang on, slow down. So if I have an IP address, that would be my. It's like my social security number.
Not really, because it can be changed. It's not this permanent thing that's assigned to you at birth. It's, you know, if you move around or you change your internet service a bit or you even play around with your router, you can get a new IP address.
Okay, so let me give you an example. If I hypothetically were looking at porn, right?
Hypothetically, yeah.
Hypothetically, and if somebody over at Pornhub, hypothetically, wanted to know who was watching that video, right?
Yeah.
They would get my IP?
They could get that.
They could get that, really? So they would know. So if I were like a porn star and I wanted to know who was watching me, right?
Yeah.
With their pants down around their ankles. They could literally get the IP address. And then the IP address would be able to tell the where I am on the planet watching that.
So if you own that site with all the porn and someone logs in, views some porn, the person that owns that site will get your IP address. And there are companies out there that have huge databases of IP addresses, and they're sort of like rough corresponding neighborhood in the U.S. or the world. And there are other companies that can say, okay, based on this neighborhood, you probably have an income in this range.
I'm more worried about the stuff that I look at on Pornhub. So so in other words, if I wanted to know who was going to, let's say, a Al-Qaeda site, okay?
Yeah.
So if somebody is logging on to Inspire, is it called Inspire? Is that the Al-Qaeda site that I write for, Scott?
It's their magazine, I think.
It's their magazine, yeah. Inspire. By the way, if you're giving out gift subscriptions.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So if I if I'm living in New York City and I go onto the Inspire website, they could find out the apartment that I'm living in based on the IP address. What would the IP address tell us?
No. The IP address doesn't say, you know, apartment 123 in this building.
What does it say?
You can use that to sort of estimate a rough location.
Well, who assigns the IP address?
That's a good question. I mean, I think it's that's a good question. I'm not too sure, actually.
And so the IP address is the address of your router? Is that correct?
It's a label assigned to the device you're using.
So could I have three? Okay, so if I have three computers in my house, all getting their internet from the same router, do they all have? They all have separate IP.
Each of those devices is going to have an IP address.
And if I take that computer out of Manhattan and into New Jersey, does my IP address?
It's going to change then. Yeah.
It changes when.
It changes when you connect to a different modem, you know? So it's not exactly like a precise thing. It's not like social security number, but there's still information you can glean from it. And
what can you glean from it?
Well, like I mentioned, you know, you can get the rough location. You can, you know, some companies will associate IP addresses with demographics and things like that, you know, so you can tell what your audience is if you're running a site.
How could you tell what – you can't tell if it's a man or a woman, can you?
I don't think they'll do that. I think that might be too specific. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And do websites use the IP address to kind of figure out
– Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean major companies will collect all the IP addresses hitting their site and then, you know, use – there's a service, a company called Axiom that will – sort of take all that IP address data and then give you a picture of what your demographic is.
Hmm.
Yeah. I mean, people that look into like brand health do this sort of thing. Yeah.
Not that I would know specifically, but I've heard third and fourth hand that sometimes on porn sites, there's a pop-up where it could be a woman saying, "Hi, I live 3 miles from where you live in," and they say
yeah,
your town.
So, exactly. Yeah.
Again, I wouldn't know, but this is what I've heard from.
Yeah.
And you know what? They really don't like you. That's one of the things they say they like you.
Right.
But when you call them, they Google Analytics, people who go to my website, there's a thing called Google Analytics. Do you know how to read Google Analytics?
Do I know how to read it?
Yeah.
I know how it works. It's you kind of put some code at the end of your website, at the end of the HTML, and it collects information on who's visiting.
Like I can't understand it, but like sometimes they'll say 80% of the visitors to your website are men. How do they know that?
I don't know. That might be the magic of Google. Maybe they have information on. I mean, everyone uses Google nowadays, right? And so they can kind of construct this picture of who's browsing what, and maybe they link that up to the IP visiting your site and make an estimate. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's kind of we have to wrap
it up.
It's
a little creepy though, right?
It is creepy. What it's also creepy about Facebook, because I used to advertise on Facebook 4 years ago, just to see how it works, and it's a really interesting, their advertising is kind of interesting, but it's a click-through policy to make money. And I go, well, how do I know? I ask them, how do I know that when you say 15 people clicked on this, how do I know that's true? Oh, because we say so. Yeah, but where's the independent audit? Oh, we don't have those. This is the first year, 2016, is the first year that Facebook is agreeing to Nielsen and an independent audit on their videos. In the past, they were saying, oh, this video got, you know, 3,000 views on Facebook, and we had to take them at their word. Now they're finally agreeing to an independent audit. How do you build a multi-billion dollar... Facebook and Google control 40% of all internet advertising. And it's all based on trust. It's all they say. They say, this is what your ad delivered. And everybody goes, oh, okay. All right. They just pay it.
And to think that the horrible fake news stuff, there's one guy who actually I was reading about today. He wasn't a Trump supporter. He was actually not a Trump supporter. And as sort of a joke, he thought he would embarrass Trump supporters by posting, like, protesters were paid $3,500 to go to Trump rallies. And he made $10,000. He monetized it, making $10,000 a month through mm-hmm. Google AdSense. So it's they have to skirt a crackdown.
Yeah, the fake news business is really frustrating because the technology to filter out the fake news has been around for like 10 plus years. Mm-hmm. It's really not that hard to do that with an algorithm.
That's
just wasn't a priority.
Well, mm-hmm. why don't we do this as a project? You're in Austin, Texas. State capital. Mm-hmm. Liberal city. Mm-hmm. What happens if you go to the Democratic Party in Austin and volunteer to help?
Yeah, I mean, I've reached out. Haven't heard anything yet. I will continue to. I think that'd be great.
And give me names. Call me back. And give me names. Karl Rove did exactly what you do. That's how he got George W. elected governor. All data analysis, right?
Mm-hmm.
And nobody wants your help. And you have a PhD in big data.
Yeah. It's tough. I mean, I think a cold email is a hard way to get noticed, you know? So I'll keep trying, though.
Is there a candidate you like?
I mean, there are people I like, but I'm also kind of struggling with how do I find a politician that needs this, that is like progressive, and you know, there's like a lot to consider. So it's kind of vague where to start with this all, you know.
I'm trying to think if I really, if I were you, I'm just trying to think what probably go. I'd go really low down the, like, you live in Austin, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
there's got to be some local politician that needs this. I mean, Hillary and at the federal level, they have massive teams, so they really don't, but.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Stay in touch, Roni, and we'll email. I don't think I helped you.
No, it's okay, David. I'll keep trying and
email me and we'll go back and forth because I'd be curious to see if there are any candidates who are looking for a volunteer because it's one thing to knock on doors, they can get people to do that, but you're stepping on toes of big politics. You have big pharma, big ag, and there's big politics. People who make a lot of money doing what you're doing, and to volunteer those services for the good of our country, that doesn't factor into the Democratic Party's plan right now. So I'm curious to see what happens.
Yeah, and let me know if you ever need help data mining for your show.
I'm trying to get
your porn history or whatever the case is.
Yeah, if I'm very encouraged. We'll go through my stats on all the podcast listeners and narrow it down to women who swallow, who live in Manhattan.
Who watch the same Pornhub sites as you do.
Women who swallow and have bad eyesight so they wouldn't be appalled by the way I look. Can we do that?
We're going to figure it out.
Okay. Thank you, Roni. Roni Kobrosly, right. Our Listener of the Week in Austin, Texas. And Roni, because you're our Listener of the Week, you get to send me
$50. What an honor. Okay, great. Thanks, David.
Thank you, Roni.
Thanks, Roni.
All right. That's our show from the Showbriz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.